Good morning, everybody. It's a beautiful day. And this morning we have Marianne, Pat, myself, Jennifer, and Diana. And we're so pleased that you're here this morning to worship with us. And welcome to those of you who are online. I believe it's going to be a beautiful service today. So please join us together and we'll stand and sing.
Couple oldies but goodies this morning. Uno momento. Do you want us to dance or something?
We joke every week when we're practicing that we're going to start doing some dance moves with the song, so you never know.
I suggested flossing, but no. Oh, here we go.
We will if you do.
Of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, it trembles at Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb. darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name.
It's a chorus, so there's just we're just going to do it three times over, okay?
Good morning, everybody. That sounded awesome, by the way, guys. Thank you. Welcome here to Union Street. We're so glad to have you here this Sunday morning. If you are new here, or if this is your first time or second time visiting us, we'd love to connect with you. There's connect cards in the seats in front of you, so fill one of those out if you want, and we have a little gift for you if you do. So, heading into announcements now, our big one for this week is February 3rd, which is this Friday coming up. It's our sleep out for our middle and high school youth. We're going to be meeting here at the church at 7 o'clock, and then staying the night, and then leaving on Saturday morning at 9 a.m. Along with the sleep out, we've been doing some fundraising. Last week I mentioned that if we reach 500, the beard's coming off, and you guys have been very excited about all that. And lots of money has been coming in. We've had over $300 come in for sure so far, and plus I think a lot more has been coming in even just this morning, so we're getting really close to our goal. I think we're going to hit it. I had other people telling me I should have just made it more because they would have just matched it. So, but really excited about that, and that's been really good. That's all finishing up this week. We have one more day for our bottle drive. If you have any bottles that you want to bring in, we're going to be collecting those this Friday morning, so just the day of the event. Feel free to bring those in. And we can take donations throughout the rest of this week still, so if you want to do that, feel free. Our book club for our Max Lucado's It's Not About Me, we were supposed to start that last Monday, but we had the bad weather, so we're going to be starting up tomorrow instead. I think same time, 10 a.m. Yeah, so we're starting that up tomorrow at 10 a.m. We have the books already, so you don't even need to worry about getting the book. If you want more info, feel free to talk to Cindy or Darlene about that. February 12th, so that's two Sundays from today, following church, we're going to have soup and sandwich, so bring a sweet and sandwich, and we'll do that. We're going to have a board game night on February 17th at 6:30 p.m., so kind of a fun night for the family. Come out for that. Annual reports. If you're doing an annual report, all of those are due no later than February 7th. Team building morning, we're going to have it on February 24th from 9 to 12:30. That's going to be for all of our volunteers. If you're connected at some capacity here doing ministry at Union Street, that's going to be a big morning for us, so February 24th. Our annual business meeting, and I had two people tell me it was important I mentioned that today, because we need to mention a month out. Annual business meeting is going to be happening on February 27th here at the church at 7 p.m., so make sure to come out to that. And then finally, just a bit down the road, but a really important one, March 5th, we're going to have a music and dessert fundraiser. That's in support of Jelana, who was our summer student here last summer. You all know Jelana. Her mission trip to the Dominican Republic. Tickets are going to be $15 and are available at the church office, so make sure to sign up for that. I'm going to invite Wade up. Wade had an announcement he wanted to share with us as well, so I will pass the mic off to him.
Thanks, Dan. I'm just trying to picture Dan without this. Well, you've been following him, have you? All right, don't want to take a lot of time. February 14th, why is that an important day? And the ladies all said Valentine's Day. Okay, so back it up 2 days. February 12th is an important day if you follow football, NFL. Football, Super Bowl, yeah! Kansas City. No, you better pray. That's all I'm saying. Okay, so we're going to have a Super Bowl viewing party here at the church on the 12th. Doors are going to open at 6:30. Game starts at 7:30. Biggest screen in town. We're going to have the sound system dialed in. You're going to be able to hear every hit that takes place. Okay? So who is this open to? It's open to everyone. It's not just a guy thing. Anybody that likes football, come. Even if you don't like football, come. We're going to have pizza. We're going to have drinks. We're going to have this thing ready to go. So it's not just for the guys. Anybody. And if you want, bring a friend. That's okay. Please. But I would like to know the numbers. If you're coming, it's not a mandatory thing, but if you're coming, let me know, please, because trying to make a few arrangements, it makes a difference if there's going to be five people here or 55. So we're just going to try and make that happen. So you can text me, put it on the Facebook page. There's an entry on the Facebook page, say that the party is a go. You could say there, yes, I'm going to go, and it's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 people, doesn't matter. So I announced this to the men's group on Wednesday night, and we were talking about fasting. So fasting, 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 and then we talk about Super Bowl party. So it's kind of like this. You got Pastor Wade on one shoulder talking about denial to self, fasting and praying, and then you got this other Wade guy on the other shoulder saying, come on, we're going to eat and drink and we're going to have a good time. I think we can get through that, okay? I think we can see the difference that takes place there. If you're going to fast Super Bowl, okay, I'll understand that. I get that. So I just want to let everybody know, this is in 2 weeks' time, here at the church, should be a pretty good gathering, I'm hoping. Should be fun. We're going to make it fun. And everybody that can come would be great. And again, you don't have to be a football fan to come and take part in this. So that's all I have. I think I remembered everything. So Dan, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Wade. All right. So before our kids head over for their ministry, I'm just going to pray. So let's bow our heads, close our eyes, and let's talk to God. Dear God, I just thank you for this morning. Just thank you for all the stuff that we have going on. Just reading through announcements, we've got lots on the go, and just thank you for all these opportunities to connect with those in our church community and with those in our greater community as well. So I just pray over all that. God, thank you for the offering that's coming in today. Thank you for everyone who's committed to furthering your kingdom work here at Union Street. We really appreciate it. And finally, God, thank you for our children, our youth. God, we pray that as they go over for their time this morning, that you would just be with them, that you'd be with their teachers, that they would teach them what you want them to learn. Thank you, God, for all this. Pray all this in your name. Amen.
See you later. It's so fun to see them all running. Oops. Good morning, Trinity. So, it's going to look a little different. We're talking about stories and God moving and answers to prayer and things I'm really excited about. Don't we just do the handheld? Lots of different options. One of the things that has just excited me this year is how our youth are listening and obeying to the call of God on their lives. That we have three youth that are taking part in mission trips. That we had Kate Choi, as you remember, at Christmas, on our Christmas Eve, we supported her. She went to Honduras. She's actually not here in person, but she has a video that we're going to share that gives her recap. I had the joy of meeting with her. Something's brewing a few days after she got back. Just a powerful testimony how she encountered God and just doing missions. Just incredible just to see, again, God work through Kate and Kate responding. We have Isaac Groom. He's a UMBSJ student, and he's coming up shortly, and he's going to Honduras as well, part of a medical team. And then we have Jill Anna, who was our summer student, and she feels very much this is her home church. She's going to be going to Dominican in May, and I think you're going in May as well, Isaac. April, May. And so it's just really exciting to see these youth answer the call of God in their lives, because when you go on a mission trip, it is like camping in the roughest spot that you can imagine. And yet you experience things that like you have never experienced before. And so I'm just really excited. I'm going to call Isaac up, and he's going to talk a little bit about his trip and how we can support him. As you're aware, in the bulletin, there was just a list of supplies. So I'll turn this over to you.
Yeah, hi, everybody. So I guess you already introduced me, but for you guys who don't know me, my name's Isaac, and I am a health student at UMB St. John, so I'm in my first year. And so I signed up with an organization called Global Brigades at the university, and about 18 of us are going to Honduras for a medic brigade. So just have a little video they're gonna show up here. It kinda explains to you guys a little more what Global Brigades is and what they're all about. So get that up. And afterwards I'll kinda tell you guys what you guys can do to help. So yeah. Maybe. Sing a song, yeah. almost there. But basically, so what the Global Brigade's kind of modeled is, so basically there's students that go down as well as physicians and nurses. And so we have different stages that the community members go through. So they go in, we like basically are in charge of signing them up, doing all the forming. And then they go in, see physicians, we assist them, and they kind of get any diagnosis that needed. And then they go in through, sometimes there's also an optical station. So if they need glasses or anything like that, get them set up with that. And then there's also a pharmacy. So we set them up with any prescriptions they need. So yeah, I don't think the video is going. All right, so basically, how can you guys help? So right now, at the very end, so they do like education seminars that we run. And basically, so we have to bring in hygiene packs. So it would be like travel size toothpaste or bars of soap, things like that. So there's a full list in the bulletin you guys can look at. So basically, I'm looking to collect some of that stuff because we have certain quantities of it that we need to bring down. So you guys can bring it. I'll kind of have a bin down back of the church. You guys can bring in as much as you want. It would be a big help. And also, I'm looking to do a fundraiser around like mid-March. So basically, I'll have some more information about that soon, kind of getting the details, find out. What we're doing is we're making bars of cookies, like boxes of cookies and bars that we're going to be selling, probably around like $10 each. So you guys can sign up, and then you can come pick them up at the church, after church, or also probably do a Saturday pickup as well. Oh, looks like we got the video. Yep, that's one. Here we go. All right.
At Global Brigades, we're committed to building a world of greater equality, in which all people are empowered to create a better life for themselves and their families. We do this by partnering with rural and under-resourced communities in Latin America and West Africa. We powerfully and concretely change the lives of our community partners by making investments in healthcare, economic development, and clean water. This empowerment process kicks off with brigades, 7 to 10 day collaborations between university students, community members, and local staff to build the community's infrastructure and capacity for development. But after a brigade is ended, what happens to the work that we've done? How is it sustained? How is it built upon? The answer to this question can be found in our relationship with Zuzular. Zuzular is a farming community in rural Honduras and one of Global Brigades' first partners. Community leaders reached out to Global Brigades back in 2009, and soon, brigades were training health workers to deliver year-round medical care, establishing a banking system to drive prosperity, and constructing a water system to bring clean water into every home. But we didn't just invest in infrastructure. We invested in people. We knew that the community's members would ultimately be the ones responsible for sustaining anything that we did. We therefore trained and cultivated local leadership and built the capacity of the community to initiate and sustain their own projects. By 2012, Zozolar didn't need us. It was providing its own members with healthcare, economic opportunity, and clean water. What Zozolar taught us is this: we're successful when a community is empowered to lead its own development. So what's Global Brigades' role in all of this? And how does our role change as a community grows more empowered? We start out as a spark. Our brigaders and staff help community members get the training, infrastructure, and support they need to kick off a holistic cycle of development. Together, we build essential infrastructure and invest in the community's capacity for development. Once the community's fires are lit, however, our job is to step back. We stop sending brigades and material assistance, and instead focus on deepening relationships with the community and supporting local leadership. We become like old friends and trusted advisors. Global Brigades technicians meet with community leaders, check up on health and water infrastructure, and consult on different initiatives. We sustain the relationship, and we ensure that the fire we helped spark years ago continues to grow for years to come. Making this transition can be hard for us sometimes. It can be tempting to think that our community partners will always need us, and that there will always be a need for more brigades. The truth we learned from Zozolar, however, is that success is when communities are empowered to lead their own development. This is when we get to celebrate. We link arms with our community partners and celebrate the change that we've made in each other's lives. Global Brigades envisions thousands of Zozolars, where every community is empowered to take charge of its own development. To get there, we're going to have to grow the movement. This is where you come in. 1, join a brigade. Work alongside peers and community members.
Yeah, so I know this video gets me really excited, but they're doing these communities and see God's work. being administered. So, yeah, it's really excited. So if you guys want to talk to me after service a little bit and find out more information, you're welcome to. And, yeah, thank you guys.
Thank you. Thank you, Isaac. And we're going to listen to Kate's testimony as her reflection on her mission trip and then some videos as well. Thank you to our tech team. We've got lots of videos this morning.
Some of you may know, I recently went on a medical missions trip to Honduras as part of Global Medical Missions Alliance, a national organization founded by Korean-American physicians and missionaries and led by college students with a passion for medical missions. I went with some of the members of my school's chapter, as well as other East Coast chapters such as Cornell University, New York University, and Binghamton University. I thought I would share briefly about what I learned from this trip and how God has spoken to me during the week. I went to Honduras expecting poor living conditions, but when I actually experienced it from sleeping on an inflatable sleeping bag on a dirty floor, drinking water through a filtered water bottle to prevent diseases, and living in unsanitary conditions in general for a whole week, my expectations were absolutely shattered. However, I realized that the focus of the trip wasn't where and how we were living, but rather the clinical and missions work we were doing. Since I had pharmacy experience, I worked in the pharmacy, mostly packaging prescriptions, explaining the instructions with the help of student translators, and communicating with the physician and the dentist to make sure we were actually meeting their demands. It was always busy, and I realized the importance of proper communication between the providers and the patients. One major realization I had was that many of these patients actually couldn't read the instructions that we were writing to them, so it was really critical for them to understand our instructions when we tell them. A particular experience I encountered really showed God's grace. Towards the end of our last clinic, we had a patient who had several teeth pulled out. She was waiting for her antibiotics and pain medications, but when my team took a bit longer to give the proper prescription, to get the proper prescription from the dentist, she left before we had the chance to give her the meds. Now, if this was Canada, it wouldn't be as big of a deal, I don't think, because we have meds from emergency departments. But this rural village was literally in the middle of a jungle. Knowing what the living conditions were like, my team and I really started to panic because we were terrified that we had done more harm than good, contradicting the number one rule in medicine, to do no harm. There was a pastor at our church who knew the patient, and he was able to deliver the meds to her in time. And this moment was just super defining for me and really showed me how God is just always great and he's just always with us. Another half of our time with the community was doing VBS, Vacation Bible School, work with the children. Dancing to Jesus is My Superhero 8 times in one session was an experience to say the least. But just seeing the joy on their faces made up for all the sweat under our scrubs. With my very basic Spanish, explaining the meaning behind every bead in the Salvation bracelets we made with the kids was a time I'll really never forget. This trip also led me to think and pray about my future, whether God wants me to potentially serve as a missionary doctor at some point in my life. So many valuable connections and friendships were formed from this trip. I just really want to thank everyone from the bottom of my heart who helped me through prayers and financial support. I was able to go on this life-changing trip that taught me so much. There's a recap video one of the leaders made from this trip for you guys to watch, and thank you again.
powerful. We have, oh dear, did you see me go in the prayer room for Kleenex? Yeah. You'll need it. You'll wish you all had Kleenex this morning. We have Paulette Matthews and Marilyn that are going to come and share some stories and what you'll see this morning about God moving, but also working in community. God that has made us for community, to do community with him and with each other. And I think of that verse in Hebrews where it tells us to spur one another on, to encourage one another in our good works, and then not to get out of the habit of meeting together. Because as we meet together, we are encouraged and we're able to pray for one another. So I'm just going to pray for Paulette and Marilyn as they're going to come up shortly. Dear God, we thank you how you are moving in our midst. We're in awe, God, how you call us to partner with you. That God, that we can see our flaws and limitations, and that's not how you see us. You see us as your beloved children, how you have uniquely placed gifts and talents in our lives so that we could partner with you, bring the hope and healing found in Jesus Christ. I thank you just for the powerful testimony of Kate, the passion of Isaac, and Jelena, that these three young people, God, already seeing you at work in their lives and just excited, God, to see how they can partner with you. And God, what a motivation for us to join you in our community, that we don't have to go globally. We can do it right here locally as well. So, Father, thank you. And I pray this morning for your presence, for your peace and power upon Paulette and Marilyn as they come and they share their stories about how you work, how you speak, how you move, God. We thank you that you are an active, loving Heavenly Father. May your name be glorified. May you continue to draw us closer to you. And as you draw us closer to you, that our lives shine the light of Jesus Christ. That as we go into our homes and our workplaces and our community, that we are bringing you with us, shining a light, bringing that hope and healing. So God, this morning again, we thank you that we can gather together, that we can be encouraged together, that we can be convicted by our youth, our young people this morning. So God, as I said already, we just pray for Marilyn and Paulette as they come up. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning. When the Holy Spirit was asking me to speak, I am definitely out of my comfort zone coming up here. But God has been so gracious and good to me all my life. There's no choice but to honor him in any way that we can. And it's hard to get up in front of all of you because you've all touched my life so much when God led me to this church in 2019. It truly is a church who lives up to what they're working towards, which is being centered in Christ and connected in community. And so many of you sitting here have touched my lives by kind words and kind deeds and through the power of prayer when prayer was really needed. I just wanted to share a little testimony of what I call one of my God stories. All my life, I have believed that my life is not about me since I've come to know the Lord, but about what I could do for somebody else. Because in all his grace and mercy, my whole life, he has done things for me and placed beautiful people in my path when I needed them most, who have reached out, and even when it's been counterintuitive, they have done beautiful things to touch my lives, and people are sitting here, some of you that have done that. When I learned throughout my life that no gesture is too insignificant if God is asking you to do it. We should always remember what may seem like a small deed to us may be our divine opportunity to be the very hands and feet of Jesus Christ to someone else. Most of you know me, have always heard me say that I love how God works, because it's so much bigger than anything we could ever dream or imagine. And I'm always in awe of what my Lord and King can do in our daily lives. You will often hear me refer to these moments as my God stories. Our greatest trials are our deepest training ground, and they can become our very testimony if we allow them to be. God doesn't want us to pretend that we're perfect to people, because we're not. We've all fallen from grace. He's forgiven us and he's loved us where we are. It is through these trials that God trains us, though, so he can use us. And it tells us that in his word, that we go through our trials so we can help somebody else. I have experienced so many times in my life when God has handpicked beautiful people to put in my life. And sometimes he chooses people to put in our path. And, you know, how can we do any less when God gave his life for us? I just want to share one of the stories that focuses on how our life is not supposed to be about us, but I learned this to do this from other people and what they have done to me, and all the glory goes to God, my Lord and King. 16 and a half years ago, on June 2nd in 2006, we were at the St. John Regional Hospital so my husband Jamie could have an MRI on his shoulder. After Jamie left to go in to be prepared to have the test and have the test, I felt God asking me to go over and speak to a woman sitting on the other side of the waiting room. You may think that I always listen to him, but I am human and sometimes I haven't. But I'm very grateful this day that his Holy Spirit was so strong in telling me I needed to go. I was sitting there and I thought to myself, really, God? I'm really comfortable sitting here. It's been a long drive from Campobello, reading my scrapbooking magazine, but his voice was loud. When I walked over to her, I told her that she didn't know me, but God had asked me to come over and talk to her. When I asked her if she was all right, she began to cry. She explained that her husband had had a heart attack and he'd been taken away, and she did not know how he was. And at this time, her family couldn't be there. Because my father had suffered several heart attacks and had open heart surgery twice, and my mom-in-law, Grandma, as we all called her, had had open heart surgery, I knew this type of journey well. That had been my training ground for this moment in time. Because God does use all things for good, even when we don't think he's going to. All time stood still, and I just sat there and talked to Mary, and reassured her she was in a good place, and shared my stories about what had happened to my dad, my mom-in-law, and how they were today. And then we just talked about many general things. And I found out a neighbor had celiac disease, and so I just inadvertently wrote down my email address because I have celiac disease and said, well, I think I could help her. She can email me and I'll talk to her. When Jamie came out, I'm very thankful for who my husband is, because when he came out, he didn't miss a beat. He just came right over, sat down with us while we were talking. You see, he's used to me doing these things. But the great part is that after all these years, when he's seen me doing this and I've shared my God stories with him, he's always gracious to listen. He also has never stopped me. Instead, he's encouraged me with whatever I feel that God is asking me to do for someone. And he knew that day that God was asking me to be there with Mary. And I shared her story with her, and we stayed. Usually you're in a rush after appointment to get home when you're from Campobello, but no, we both felt God asking us to stay there that day. And we just stayed with Mary. None of her family was there, and I felt the Holy Spirit saying, go get her something to eat, Paulette. And so I told her we would be back. We were just going to go to the cafeteria, and we would bring her some things to eat. And when we left and came back, she was gone. I didn't think I'd ever see her again. But I left the things at the main desk for her to have, so when she came out, she would have something to eat. It had been a long day. I think 5 days later, you can imagine my shock when I received an email from Mary's husband, Harold Crowell. As I can't remember his exact words, I would like to just read you part of the email. Yes, I still have it because it was a story that has changed, continued to change my life. Paulette, I would like to take the opportunity to thank you from the bottom of my heart for all your thoughts and kindness to my wife and I on the event of my heart attack in the St. John Regional Hospital on the 2nd of June. We, and especially my wife Mary, consider you as an angel sent from heaven to comfort and console Mary when she was suddenly left all alone when I went to the cath lab for my work there. She has spoken of you often, and to everyone she talks about, she says how you just suddenly appeared and came from nowhere to offer comfort and love, and she was convinced she was visited by an angel. Don't worry, I assured Harold I was anything but an angel, but he did know that God had sent me. And the last thing he ended his email with is, in closing, you can be assured that Mary and I will not forget you, and I am hopeful that sometime in the future, I will be able to meet you and your husband personally. Well, the story, God's story, didn't end there. Through the years, Harold and I have stayed in touch, and we've been praying for each other for so many things. My son, when he had atrial fibrillation episodes and procedures, my breast cancer journey, they were praying for me. Mary's heart attack, we were praying for them. Mary's cancer journey, I could walk with her because I had walked that journey and pray with her. When my husband had health issues, when my daughter was having complications and she had babies, we've continued to pray for each other. Mary is now 79 and Harold is 81. And last week, I called to ask permission to use their names and share this testimony, and they said, of course. Of course, God had deeper plans for that phone call. I found out when I called that we needed to pray. And so I'm asking you to lift them up in prayer, too, as they have done so often for so many. Mary goes back for her scan of her lung next month to check for cancer. Please pray for that scan. I know what it feels like to walk back up when you've walked through cancer to be scanned to see if the cancer's come back. It's a I can't breathe moment, and you go in alone with God. But she also told me, and her, I'm gonna try not to cry, but her granddaughter Peyton and her mom Ashton need prayers. Peyton is in the IWK in Halifax. She is only 20 months old. She is going through cancer treatments. She has had a lump removed from her leg where the cancer was, and she's going through therapy. I've been through cancer treatments. I can't imagine being a 20-month-year-old child and going through them. So I'd like to ask you that you please pray for Mary, her granddaughter Peyton, and Peyton's mom, Ashton. My challenge to each of you is to look and see who God places in your path and listen to his still small voice. Maybe he's asking you to make a phone call or send that text message or an email. Maybe it is as simple as to say a kind word or give a reassuring smile. No gesture is too insignificant or small if God is asking you to do it. Thank you.
I've practiced this so many times at home and I haven't cried, but I'm sure I'm going to. A few weeks ago, when Angela first mentioned that she was hoping to have a few people share stories of how God has worked in their lives, I heard her, but didn't give it another thought. Although I am a teacher, I've never really loved speaking in front of groups of people, so I didn't think she could be talking to me. Besides, I didn't really have a story to tell, or so I thought. God had other plans. A little over a week ago, I heard him telling me that I was one of the people Angela was looking for. I ignored him at first, but the nudge became stronger. I could no longer ignore it. So I called Angela to tell her about the nudge, but that I truly had no idea what God was calling me to share. She, knowing some of my story, gave me some suggestions, but encouraged me to pray about it. As I prayed, I began to write some notes, and soon the words began to flow. At the beginning of January, Angela challenged us to pray for a word and a verse to meditate on for 2023. My word is self-worth. My verse is Ephesians 2:10 in the New Living Translation, "For we are God's masterpiece. He created us anew in Christ Jesus so we can do the things he planned for us long ago." The word masterpiece resonates with me because a masterpiece has great value. And for so much of my life, I have felt like I don't have value. I know and believe that God created me in his image, but feeling that truth has not come easily. I have battled depression since I was a teenager and have often believed the lies of the enemy that I didn't matter, that no one cared, and that no one would miss me if I wasn't here. God has been faithful, however, even when I wasn't seeking him. I grew up going to church, but did not have a personal relationship with Christ. Thankfully, I've come to know Jesus as my Lord and Savior. As Angela often says, God relentlessly pursues us, and I praise and thank him for that. There have been many times over the years that I have pulled back from God, regardless of whether I was trying to do things in my own strength or I was feeling like I was undeserving of God's grace and mercy. He never left me. God's faithfulness has been evident in my life in many ways. One example is how he has placed people, both personal and professional, in my life to support and encourage me when I needed it most. Some of those times have been during times of grief. Any loss can cause a person to experience grief. Death of a loved one, loss of a friendship, loss of an anticipated opportunity, the loss of the ability to do things you were once able to do. One of my first real experiences with grief, and the first that had a huge impact on me, was nearly 33 years ago when our first baby was stillborn at full term. It was a devastating loss. However, God was faithful, and I experienced peace in the extreme sadness. While some people expected, and in fact encouraged me, to be angry, to lay blame on someone, even to take legal action, that's not how I felt. Despite being absolutely crushed by Laura's death, I felt a comfort that can only be explained by God. Many people with similar experiences reached out to us, and over the years, I've been able to reach out to others who have suffered miscarriage, which we experienced a few years later, and stillbirth. I have been told that this has been a blessing, and that is certainly how I would describe how others supported us. God gave me strength and courage to do that. He used my pain to help others in theirs. I've experienced other losses over the years, but I really thought I had dealt with the grief of losing Laura until 5 years ago when my sister-in-law died of cancer. Stacy's death brought all the raw emotions I had felt when Laura died flooding back to me. Once again, God was faithful. He provided the opportunity to see a Christian counselor who helped me process these feelings and many others I had buried and rely more on God. I've come to realize that grieving can be complicated, unpredictable, and very individual. As many of you know, 3 months ago, my youngest brother, Kevin, died by suicide. It is a loss that has sent my entire family, as well as many in the community, reeling. I've experienced a wide range of emotions during the last 3 months. But once again, overriding it all has been a sense of peace within myself that only comes from God. Am I sad? Yes. Am I mourning Kevin's death and the loss of the years I thought he would have on earth with his wife and girls? Yes. Do I understand why Kevin died? No. Do I have questions? Yes. Do I trust that even though I do not know how or when, that God will use this pain? Yes. Something that Christians should never have to experience pain. The truth is exactly the opposite. In John 16:33, Jesus tells us, "I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." Despite having questions and not always finding the answers, God is my refuge and strength. My faith in him carries me when I cannot carry myself. We are not meant to bear our burdens on our own. I am thankful for every person that he has placed in my path that has helped to develop and deepen my faith. I give God all the glory and praise for where I am today and trust that the more I seek him, the closer to him I will be.
Thank you, Paulette and Marilyn. I'm going to call the worship team and we're going to sing this song, Raise Hallelujah, because as these ladies have shared, and I'm sure it's been your story as well, that when we're dealing with loss and grief, that when we look to God, he gives us that strength, that he is faithful in that storm, in that moment. And so I'll invite you to stand as we sing this last song.
In the past.
powerful. I would invite you back tonight at 6:30. We have an encounter, which is worship and praise, and a chance to hear a few more stories as well. So just as you go out this week, I pray that this song will just resonate in those stories, that God is with you, that he is for you, and if you were in the middle of a storm, to raise hallelujah. Now may the love of God, the grace of Jesus, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit go with you. Have a great week.